Good morning. Can you see slide?
Yes, Doc. Visible na po.
Okay. So, thank you for inviting me dito sa ating Usapang Salun-at for this month. Since it is our celebration of the National Family Planning Month. Okay, we have our theme for this year, which is Bata-Bata, Planado Kang Ginawa. At magandang umaga po. Ako si Dr. Ana Maureen Franco, isang OB-gynecologist po dito sa Family Planning Clinic ng Baguio General Hospital and Medical Center. So, ang pag-uusapan natin ngayon ay tungkol sa family planning. So, ano ang unang pumapasok sa isip mo kapag narinig mo ang salitang family planning? At ano naman yung mga maling akala at paniniwala tungkol sa family planning? So, this lecture or this session will help us correct yung mga paniniwala tungkol sa mga maling akala sa family planning. So, at this lecture or usapang salun-at natin, we will be able to recognize the significance of family planning. We will be able to define the health and responsible parent, and identify, describe the different family planning methods and answer yung mga frequently na tinatanong ng ating mga clients, and to correct the common myths and misconception on the use of contraceptives. Okay. So, our family planning program is a national program with a legal basis. It is integrated in the RPRH law or the Republic Act 10354. It is also part of the Philippine Development Plan for 2017 and up to 2022. And it is an integral part of the UHC or the Universal Healthcare Republic Act 11223. So, sabi sa Universal Healthcare and Family Planning, all Filipinos are able to access quality and affordable health services they need without exposing to financial hardship. So, yung family planning services should be given freely and it is accessible sa ating community. And it has been also said that planning the family means greater opportunities for a healthier community. According to WHO or the World Health Organization, yung family planning is a means to attain the desired number of children and determine the spacing of pregnancies. Yung it is rooted on the main concepts to the number of desired children, the ability to determine the desire and ability to attain the desire and ability to determine the spacing of pregnancies. The health outcomes, particularly it is improvement health outcomes directed to the maternal and infant health. And the key messages of the family planning program is not all about contraceptives. Hindi lang po yung mga contraceptive methods ang dapat nabigyang tuon sa family planning program. It is not only for the benefit of the one using it, and it should be an effort of the couple to ensure that their family have the quality of life that they desire. Yung family planning natin, we have four guiding principles. We have the respect for the sanctity of life, which is we don't minsan kasi ang iniisip kapag contraception it is a form of abortion, which is wrong. Family planning or the use of contraception will prevent abortion because it will prevent unintended pregnancies, and abortion is not equal to family planning. Also, respect for human rights, so whichever race you're from, kahit anong religion mo, anong sex mo, you're a male, a female, or ano ang gender preference mo, you have the right for the access of family planning services. Freedom of choice and voluntary decision. Ibig sabihin po nito, the information should be given to the clients and it is their choice and their decision. So it's an informed choice. Hindi po tayo, as a healthcare provider, we are not, we don't have the right to coerce our clients kung ano yung gusto natin para sa kanila. We are just there to help them decide, to guide them on what is appropriate for them. And there is respect for the rights of our clients. It is also the right of the clients to choose kung kailangan ba nila yung short acting lang o kaya yung long acting, kung ilang children ang gusto nilang, number of children that they want to attain. So that's their right to choose. So punta po tayo ngayon kung ano ba yung benefits and importance of our family planning. It has different benefits, especially sa couple. So we'll start with the mother. Merong ginawang acronym ang ating DOH, PAPCOM, and the other agencies wherein it will give mental stability to the mother. So burden and responsibility is lightened. The opportunity to care for self, children, and spouse is strengthened. The treatment time is enough after delivery. There is enough time for the mother to heal, and high-risk pregnancies are prevented. Education and the time for development is also strengthened, and the regain of health is better. And for our fathers, full attention to the children will be given. There's advancement of personal goals and opportunities. There's also time to actively participate in the community programs and project. The couple will be healthier. Security is ensured, and all the supplies or the basic needs will be replenished easily. So the family, it's acronym as LOVE. So the family will live fully and fruitfully. There's the opportunity to save for the future. Valuable time is spent and enable the family to meet their needs. For the children, what's benefit for the children? There will be comfort and confidence. They will be more healthy. They will reach their highest potential, and their security is also ensured. Sa komunidad naman po, ano po yung benefits ng family planning? We can prevent HIV or AIDS. It reduces, like what you've said, yung primary goal ng ating, the ultimate goal of our family planning program in the Philippines is to reduce maternal and infant mortality rate also. And it empowers the people and enhances education. It also reduces the demand for health and education and the social services of the country or the community. The per capita investment increases in health, education, and social protection, and sustainable population growth is attained. So now, punta na po tayo sa ating main topic. So we have our facts about the family planning, which will correct the myths and misconception on family planning. Yan. Ang una po laging tinatanong ng ating mga kliyente, is family planning a form of abortion? Hindi po. Why? Because abortion is ending pregnancy, while family planning or the use of contraception prevents pregnancy through the use of the contraceptives. And family planning prevents induced abortion by helping couple avoid unplanned pregnancies. Kasi nga po, di ba, kapag unplanned yung pregnancy, ang kapag ayaw pa talagang magbuntis ng couple, ang nangyayari, nagkakaroon po tayo ng induced abortion. So, it is not, family planning is not a form of abortion. Are family planning methods harmful to health? Ito ba'y nakakasama sa ating kalusugan? Sagot po natin dito ay hindi. Because all family planning methods are safe and effective if properly used. Couples can choose the method that is best or hiyang sa kanila. So yung kagayang sabi natin kanina, we inform our patients on the different methods and help them decide on what is suitable for them. And they can decide on the on what method, because that's their goal, to decide on the desired number and spacing of their children. So tatanungin din tayo, effective po ba 'yan? Method na yung method na napili po nila. So tatanungin sa atin, effective ba ito? Gaano siya ka-effective? So the effectiveness of the different methods varies a lot depending on how the method is used by the couple or the individual. Ibig pong sabihin, kung correctly and properly used po yung ating family planning method, it is very effective. Isa rin po ito sa pinaka-laging tinatanong ng ating mga client or mga pasyente, will a contraceptive method decrease sexual desire? Di po ba tinatanong tayo, nababawasan po yung gana ng ating couple? So, ang sagot po dito ay hindi. Kasi yung sexual desire naman po is iba-iba sa ibang tao. So, it varies from person to person. So, the use of contraceptive does not affect an individual sexual desire. And actually nga po, yung the use of contraceptives will free the couple from fear of unplanned pregnancies. Kaya po, mas na-enhance yung couple sexual relationship. Kasi hindi na po sila mag-worry or mag-aalala. Baka mabubuntis yung partner. Kaya the sexual relationship will be better and enhanced. So tinatanong din po, magkano po ba yung mga family planning methods? Mahal po ba yung mga ito? Or saan po ba ako makakakuha nito? So ang family planning methods are not expensive. Actually, they are most of our methods are free. Most of the commodities are free. And some are reasonably priced and available at drugstores. Kung meron man yung hindi available sa ating mga rural health units or sa ating mga family planning clinics, they are also available in the different drugstores but in a reasonably and affordable price. So there are companies that provide family planning supplies to their employees. And it is a good thing that yung PhilHealth po, it covers the cost of family planning counseling, IUD, insertion, bilateral tubal ligation, vasectomy, injectable implants, and yung initial cycle of progestin-only pills. And these are subject to the provision on the benefit package for the members and dependents. So pati yung dependents po, pwede nilang i-avail for free kung merong PhilHealth yung kanilang mother or father. Planning methods. We'll not discuss orally on this topic. We'll just go over them. So we have more methods. We have our traditional methods. So under the natural family, meron din tayong natural family planning and the artificial. So punta tayo sa mga natural methods, which includes our cervical mucus or yung Billings ovulation method, yung ating BBT or basal body temperature, yung symptothermal method, standard days method, lactation amenorrhea method. We also have our long-acting methods. Ito na yung mga mas common na ginagamit natin ngayon. We have our IUD and our subdermal implants or the progestin-only subdermal implant. And under our short acting, we have our injections, yung pills, and yung male condom, which is under the barrier method. And our permanent methods, as we all know, yung female sterilization, ito po yung tubal ligation, bilateral tubal ligation, and we also have male sterilization or yung vasectomy. So we have our traditional family planning methods, which are the withdrawal or the coitus interruptus, and the calendar or rhythm method or periodic abstinence. This is not actually advocated because the unmet need for modern family planning is high kapag yun po ang ginagamit natin. So, we aim to have a zero unmet need. Ano po ba yung unmet need? Ito po yung number ng mga kababaihan na gustong mag-spacing ng mga anak nila, and gusto rin na ilimit yung number ng children. However, they are not using modern family planning methods. So, ito ang goal ng executive order under President Duterte, na Executive Order 12, which aims to have a zero unmet need. So, dapat ang goal natin, lahat ng kababaihan na gustong mag-spacing and mag-limit ng number ng children should use modern family planning method. Okay, so yung mga temporary methods natin, we have the fertility awareness base. Yan na yung tawag natin sa kanila ngayon, or yung FAB methods. Ang kailangan po natin dito is it involves the determination of the fertile and infertile periods of a woman within the menstrual cycle. Ibig sabihin, kailangan alam mo yung katawan mo, yung minomonitor mo yung katawan mo, and the effectiveness kasi depends on yung ability to identify yung fertile and infertile periods. At saka kailangan pati yung partner, there is motivation to practice abstinence when required. So, yun lang yung drawback o yung disadvantage ng ating mga FAB methods, kasi kailangan alam mo kung you should identify yung date na pwede kayong mag-contact, you should identify the date na hindi kayo pwedeng mag-contact. Kaya kailangan may participation si partner. So, in summary of our FAB methods, we have the cervical mucus or Billings, the BBT, symptothermal method, standardized method, lactation amenorrhea, and the two-day method. Now, we go to our modern artificial methods. Modern artificial. Artificial means meron na po siyang gamot na kasama, kagaya ng mga hormones. So, we have our short-acting method, like what I've said, yung barrier natin, although wala siyang kasamang gamot or hormone, we have our condom. And our hormonal methods includes our pills, injectable, and also the subdermal implant. And our long-acting methods, ibig sabihin, mas matagal po yung effectiveness nila, which includes our IUD and our subdermal implant. Okay, we go to the condom. So we all know that the condom is worn by the male over the penis during sexual intercourse. It prevents the sperm from entering the vagina. And it is, the advantage of the condom is, kapag meron tayong mga sexually transmitted infections or diseases, it also prevents transmission to the partner by the use of condom. Okay, and it is effective 98%. And we go to our hormonal, which are the pills. It prevents ovulation and thickens the cervical mucus. And it prevents the sperm from entering the uterus. So ito, punta na po tayo sa ating mga kailangang alamin, pag-usapan, para ito po yung isasagot natin sa ating mga clients when they ask us about the family planning methods na pipiliin po nila. So, we go to the pills. Kung ano ba yung mga laging tinatanong tungkol sa pills. So if I do not wish to get pregnant, should I take pills only on days that I have sex with my husband? Ang tanong po nila usually, iinumin ko lang ba to kapag magtatalik kami ng aking asawa? Ang sagot po natin ay hindi. Dapat araw-araw po yung pag-take ng pills para hindi tayo mabuntis. Every day po yun. Kasi meron tayong 21 tablets and meron tayong 28 tablets. So, kailangang ubusin po yun and then start another pill kung ayaw pa po nating magbuntis. It doesn't necessarily mean na kailangang i-take mo lang siya kapag magse-sexual contact kayo ni partner or ni husband. It should be every day. So, another question, common question ng ating clients, do pills cause cancer? So, ang sagot natin dito, no, kasi it has been over 45 years, mas matanda yung pills kaya akin, nagagamit na on. So, it's been safely by millions of women for over 45 years. It has been tested and studied more than any other drug. At dahil sa pag-aaral na ito, they found out that pills can prevent women from some forms of cancer such as the ovary and the uterus. So, more clinical studies are currently being conducted. So, may mga pag-aaral pa rin ngayon if there is association of pill use with other forms ng cancer. Pero basically po, pag tinanong, can it cause cancer? Ang sagot po natin ay hindi. Isa pa pong question, can pills cause infertility or make it difficult for me to become pregnant once I stop taking it? Ang sagot din po dyan ay no, kasi it has been shown that pills do not cause infertility. Actually nga po, after mo i-stop gamitin, anytime pwede ka nang mabuntis. They do not reduce your chances of becoming pregnant once you stop taking them. So, pag tinigil ang pills, pwede nang mabuntis po anytime. And it will not cause infertility. Ito po, ang pinaka tinatanong din ng ating mga kababaihan, do pills cause abortion? Ang sagot po niyan ay no. Pills are taken as a contraception, not to cause abortion. So, ang mode of action naman po ng ating pills, ang ginagawa po talaga nila is to prevent ovulation. Ibig sabihin, hindi po nangingitlog ang isang babae kapag nagtatake po siya ng pills. So, ibig sabihin, kung hindi ka mangingitlog, wala pong fertilization na mangyayari. So, kung wala po siyang fertilization, there will be no pregnancy. Kaya, ang abortion is, hindi siya pwedeng mangyari kung hindi ka naman nabuntis. Okay? So, the pills will not cause abortion. Kasi in the first place, walang pagbubuntis na mangyayari if we take pills. Another question. So, do pills cause vaginal dryness leading to painful sexual intercourse? No, there are no evidence showing that pills cause vaginal dryness. And it will not lead to painful sexual intercourse. So, sasabihin ng client sa atin, since matagal na po akong umiinom ng pills, will pills build up in my body after a few years? Kailangan ko bang mag-stop taking the pills to give my body a rest period? Meron tayong naririnig na ganun, yung mga rest period. Magpapahinga po muna, ganun. Pero ang sagot po dito, hindi. Hindi po nag-accumulate or hindi naiipon yung pills na tinatake natin sa ating katawan. The pills dissolve and get absorbed in your body and excreted just like other medicines and food. So pag tinake na natin, madidissolve, inaabsorb ng katawan, doon na po mag-detection kung ano yung dapat na gagawin ng hormone sa ating katawan. So now we go to injectable, which is also a hormonal contraceptive. Ano ba yung kanyang mode of action? Or ano ba talaga ang ginagawa ng injectable? Bakit hindi tayo nabubuntis? So, ang action nito is it thickens the cervical mucus o yung fluid na nandun sa ating cervix, yung sinesecrete ng ating cervix, which prevents sperm from entering the uterus. So, kapag makapal po yung cervical mucus natin, ibig sabihin, nababarahan or nahaharang yung ating sperm. So, it's mahirap po sa kanila na makapasok sa ating uterus. So, we have our common na injectable, yung Depo Provera, na ginagamit natin libre sa ating mga RHU, sa family planning clinics, and different agencies na bibigay ng free family planning methods. So, it also stops ovulation changes in the uterus. Fallopian tubes with prevents fertilization. So, kagaya rin po nung ating pills, hindi po tayo nangingitlog kapag nag-i-injectable po tayo. So, like what I've said, kung hindi po tayo mangingitlog, walang pagbubuntis na mangyayari, kaya effective po siya to, as a contraceptive method. Ano naman po yung mga tinatanong tungkol sa ano, sa ating injectable or yung ating Depo Provera? Ito rin, yung do injectables cause permanent infertility? Ang sagot natin dito ay hindi. Kasi as soon as 3 to 4 months after your last shot, pwede ka nang mabuntis. Although ang average mean or yung average na months kung kailan ka talaga mabubuntis when you are using injectable. When using injectable is mga 9 to 10 months. Kung pag matagal na po tayong nag-i-injectable, let's wait for 9 to 10 months before tayo mabuntis, before we can say na mabubuntis na tayo. So it's not permanent infertility. Hindi po siya nagko-cause ng permanent infertility. As usual, yung tanong po sa atin, do injectables cause cancer? The answer is no. Because, syempre, sa mga pag-aaral din po, injectables do not increase the risk of ovarian and cervical cancer and are associated with less chance of cancer of the lining of the uterus. Clinical studies found that there are no overall risk of breast cancer. Okay, so, sorry. Oh, so, does it also cause abortion? So, ang answer pa rin natin dito, hindi. Kasi wala nga pong nagaganap na pagbubuntis. Kaya, wala pong pregnancy. So, walang abortion. Another question is, magsusuka ba ako? Mahihilo-hilo ba ako if gagamit ako ng injectables? So, ang answer natin ay hindi. Hindi rin po. Wala pong usual na na-experience ang mga kababaihan natin na may nahihilo o nagsusuka when they are given the injectables. For example, sasabihin ng pasyente, naka-injectable po ako. If I get pregnant while using the injectable, will it harm my baby? So, anong sagot natin? Siyempre, mag-worry sila. Nag-injectable sila, pero bakit nabuntis sila? Since nandun na, buntis na si mother, ang tanong ngayon, will it harm the baby? So, ang sagot natin is, hindi. Dahil, pregnancy during injectable actually is very rare, and in the rare event that the woman becomes pregnant while using the injectable, wala pong harm na mangyayari sa baby kasi yung hormone ng injectable is the same hormone that the woman is producing during the pregnancy, which is our progesterone. pong sa loob ng mattress ko yung aking mens? Ano yung sagot po natin dito? Hindi. Kasi yung menstrual blood is not is stored in the uterus. It is common nga na hindi tayo nagre-regla when we are using DMPA, but it is not harmful. Kasi nga po, yung action ng injectable, minsan, mas manipis yung lining ng mattress, so wala po tayong ireregla or wala tayong kailangang iregla. So hindi na tayo nagme-mens when we are using the DMPA. Manipis lang yung lining ng mattress, wala tayong ireregla, kaya no monthly cycle. Kaya sabihin natin walang naiipon na dugo or mens sa loob ng ating mattress. Yun po ang isagot natin. Okay, so we move on to our intrauterine device. So marami rin po tanong tungkol sa ating IUD. Ano ba yung action kasi ng IUD? Bakit hindi tayo nabubuntis? So it prevents sperm from meeting the egg. Ano po nangyayari sa loob? Kasi nilalagay po natin yung IUD sa loob. Here, and then, during insertion, magkakaroon na po siya ng ano. Pag na-insert na po yung IUD natin sa loob, magkakaroon po ng reaction yung ating fluid dito with the copper. So, yung fluid na yon magkukause po siya ng sterile inflammation. So, that will prevent the sperm na mag-move. So, parang napaparalyze yung sperm kapag na-expose siya doon sa sterile inflammation dito sa loob ng mattress. So, kapag na-paralyze na yung sperm, hindi na siya makagalaw, hindi na po sila mag-meet ng itlog sa fallopian tube. So, walang meeting na nangyayari, walang tagpuan, walang pagtatagpo. So, wala pong fertilization. Kung walang fertilization, walang pregnancy. Okay? So, moving on sa ating mga questions sa intrauterine device. Oh, ito po. Kapag naka-IUD po ba ako tapos nabuntis ako, yung IUD ba pupunta doon sa loob ng katawan ni baby or sa ibang organs? Anong sagot natin? Hindi. Kasi IUD cannot be implanted in a baby's body or any other organs of the baby. It also does not cause malformation of the fetus. Minsan paglabas ni baby, nandun na lang, hawak-hawak niya yung ano, yung implant, yung IUD, or sumasama na lang siya when the baby is being delivered, sumasama na yung IUD natin. It is not harmful to the baby. Kapag naka-IUD ba, will I still be able to have baby? The answer is opo, yes. Because almost all women who use an IUD will be able to bear children once it is removed. Once na tinanggal na po natin yung IUD, anytime po, once nag-ovulate ang mother and then merong sexual intercourse, anytime, mabubuntis na po si mother. Ito din po, medyo concerned din po sila sa kanilang partners. So, tatanungin nila, can the string of an IUD get entangled with the man's penis during sex? Actually, hindi. Because yung string po niya is very short and hindi siya pwedeng mag-entangle with the penis during sex. Once the IUD is inserted kasi, yung string becomes soft and coils within the vagina. Parang umiikot po yung, mas malambot na siya and it folds and coils doon sa posterior part ng cervix. Kaya po, hindi po yun mag-entangle dun sa ating penis. And it is really short. After insertion kasi kinakat din po siya. So, it is just as short as mga 2 to 3 centimeter na long, but it will not cause any entanglement with the penis of the partner. Okay, so nabubulok po ba yung IUD? Yun din pag tinatanong sa atin kapag matagal na nasa uterus. Our IUD is effective for 12 years actually. So after 12 years ba, kapag hindi natanggal, pwede siyang mabulok? So ang sagot po natin, hindi. IUD is made of inert material which does not rot in the uterus even with prolonged use. Actually nga, meron pang mga patient kahit 80 years old, nandun pa rin yung IUD nila, hindi na po nila pinatanggal. And it doesn't cause any harm to them. Hindi naman po nagkakaroon ng problema. So, hindi na rin po nila pinapatanggal. And it will not, hindi po siya nabubulok. Can IUD be pushed out of the uterus during sex and travel to other parts of woman's body? Hindi rin po. Ang sagot dito ay hindi. Hindi siya maitutulak outside the uterus during sex, and the IUD will usually and normally stays within the uterus until it is removed by a trained healthcare provider. There's no passage. Wala na po siyang dadaanan pag nandun na siya sa uterus. It cannot, imposible po, it's not possible to travel to other organs of the body. So if ever ma-expel, it will only come out from the vagina. Doon lang po yung daanan niyang papasok at lalabas. So another din po, yung IUD ba, it get yung contact with the ano sa penis ng ating partner. The answer here is no. Yung string, like what we've said a while ago, yung string lang po yung nandun sa may cervix, and the IUD is inside the uterus. So it will not even be felt by the man. And in the rare cases where the man can feel the string, the woman can, kailangang ipacheck na lang ng ating kliyente kung mafe-feel nila na may tumutusok, or yung IUD mafe-feel nung partner na dumidikit dun sa kanyang ari. So yung mother should go to the family planning provider kung saan siya nagpa-insert para tignan kung may problema. And syempre, on the financial side, will PhilHealth pay for an IUD and its insertion? The answer is yes. Kagaya ng sinabi po natin kanina, yung PhilHealth, if you are a member or a dependent, the IUD and its insertion are covered by the PhilHealth. Meron po tayong family planning benefit package ng PhilHealth which will provide for which will pay for the insertion. And now moving to our subdermal implant, which is a common as of the moment pinakamarami na po ang nagpapalagay ng subdermal implant. So what is a subdermal implant? Ito yung tinatawag natin na Implanon, yung brand po niya ngayon. So it is a progestin only. Ibig sabihin progesterone lang po yung laman niya. It is inserted under the skin, sa ilalim lang siya ng balat, on the inner upper arm of a woman. So dito po, maliit lang na butas, ipapasok siya dito, and then under the skin. And the action of this is the same din po sa ibang mga hormonal method natin. It suppresses ovulation and it thickens cervical mucus and hinders the sperm from passing through the cervical canal. So yun yung mga effect ng ating subdermal implant. Kaya hindi po tayo nabubuntis. Okay, so di po ba ito yung common questions ng ating mga pasyente? Kapag na-insert na daw ba yung implant sa kanila, will the implant travel to the different parts of the body? The answer is no. The implant should stay, and it is normally subdermally palpated until it is being removed by the trained healthcare provider. So 3 years po ang effectivity ng ating implant or the Implanon. And if the patient wants the implant to be removed, yun lang po yung time na tatanggalin siya by a trained healthcare provider, and it does not travel to any part of the body. parang mali yung nandito. So, do, hindi injectables. Yung implant cause permanent sterility or infertility? No. Because as soon as you remove or discontinue the implant or pinatanggal na, the mother can get pregnant quickly. Implant or long-acting reversible contraceptives are only for those who have had children. Totoo po ba ito? Mali. No. Ang implant is suitable for women of any reproductive age. Kahit po may anak, nagkaanak na or wala pa pong anak, if they still want to delay pregnancy or childbearing, we can insert the implant at any age. Any reproductive age. The same question then kapag nag-injectable, same din sa implant. Kasi usually sa implant, wala din tayong menstruation. So, is my menstrual blood stored inside my uterus? Ang sagot pa rin natin, hindi po. Hindi po yan totoo at the answer is no. So, though it is common nga na when we are using implant, we stop, some clients will stop having their period. So, walang menses na medyo matagal. So, yung menstrual blood natin, hindi naman po na-store inside the uterus kasi nga, sabi natin kanina, yung lining ng ating uterus is thin and so wala tayong ipoproduce na menstruation, menstrual blood. So wala po tayong monthly cycle when using the implant. And this is not harmful. Hindi po siya karamdaman at hindi po siya nakakasama sa atin. Okay, so moving on to our permanent methods. This is a more interesting method na laging tinatanong ng patients because it is permanent kasi wala nang atrasan. Once we say magpapaligate na, wala na po tayong dapat decided po talaga sila na ligation or vasectomy ang gagawin because it's a permanent method. So, it is more appropriate. The permanent method is more appropriate for couples that have decided to complete their number of children. Kung na-attain na po nila yung kanilang mga, kung ilang anak ang gusto nila, pwede po natin i-offer yung permanent method. So, sa ating mga kababaihan, ang ginagawa po natin ay ang ating bilateral tubal ligation or BTL. It is also called a female sterilization. So, ang nangyayari dito, yung ating fallopian tubes are cut and tied. So, puputulin at tatahiin, tatalian, tatahiin. Meron tayong ginagawa na kapag after delivery or postpartum delivery ng mga patients sa ating ward, nagagawa na po natin yung bilateral tubal ligation kahit pagkapanganak pa lang. Ang disadvantage lang nito, it is a procedure that requires yung anesthesia natin. Sometimes we use the spinal or yung sa likod, ilalagay yung anesthesia para hindi maramdaman pag nag-opera, pag inoperahan yung ating pasyente. And we also have our local anesthesia na ginagamit natin sa mga, sometimes sa interval din and yung mini lap lang siya. Maliit lang yung incision below the umbilicus or sa pusod natin. May maliit na incision na gagawin and it will just use our local anesthesia. So, yung ating bilateral tubal ligation, ikakat ang fallopian tube and tatahiin or itatay. Okay, so ganito po yung nangyayari. Cut and tie or suture dito. Dito yung kinakat po natin kasi dito po nagmi-meet yung ating sperm and egg. Dito sa ovary, manggagaling yung ating itlog pag nag-ovulate tayo at pag may sexual contact, yung sperm imimit niya, magtatagpo sila dito sa ating fallopian tube. Dito po magaganap ang fertilization na sinasabi natin and then eventually pupunta sa matres para doon mag-implant and it will continue yung pregnancy. So, kapag nakat po natin ang tubong ito, yung ating fallopian tube, pag nakat na natin yan and tie, it will be blocked. So, wala na pong tagpuan na mangyayari, magaganap. Okay? So, ano ba yung mga tinatanong sa atin ng ating mga kliyente when it comes to the bilateral tubal ligation topic? Ito po, yung number one. So, will I become sick and be unable to work kapag nagpa-ligate po ako? Ang sagot po natin dyan, hindi. Kasi after ligation, you can resume your regular activities as long as you are comfortable to do the activity and as soon as you are free from post-procedure discomfort like yung pain and may kung kunwari meron tayong may bleeding pa rin and other symptoms na ma-observe natin. After that, if you're free from those discomfort, you may resume to your regular activities. The procedure will not make you sick, neither will it affect your ability to work. So, di ba tinatanong tayo, hindi ka na pwede magbuhat? Hindi po totoo yon. Kapag kaya nyo pa po yung mga activities, yung dati nyong ginagawa, regular activities, pwede nyo pa rin pong gawin kahit na po na-ligate na po kayo. Okay, so usually we advise our patients to take 2 to 3 days rest and avoid lifting of heavy objects for a week. Kasi nga, medyo meron ka pang mararamdaman na konting discomfort, kaya ina-advise namin yung mga pasyente na mag-rest muna until you are really, really free from post-procedure discomfort. Okay, so does it shorten the lifespan of a woman? Sabi nila, mas madali na daw, mas ano daw, yung madaling mamatay ang mga na-ligate. Ito po ay walang katotohanan or the answer is no. So, matagal na pong ginagawa yung bilateral tubal ligation. It has been practiced for several generations and wala pong evidence na nakita na it shortens our lifespan or our lives as women, will not even shorten it. Ito rin po, pag na-ligate ba ako, magme-menopause na ako? Yun din po yung tanong sa atin. So, ang sagot po ay hindi. Kasi, it will not stop menopause. Yung ligation, ay it will not, hindi niya pabibilisin yung menopause. Yung ligation is yung fallopian tube lang naman ang tinanggal natin, ang kinat natin. After the procedure, you will continue to ovulate. Mangingitlog po pa rin tayo. Magre-regla pa rin po tayo. Pero, hindi na lang po tayo mabubuntis. So, ma-attain pa rin natin or we will still reach our menopause and we will still experience the menopause dun sa tamang edad na magme-menopause na po tayo. Hindi ibig sabihin na na-ligate is mag-early menopause. Hindi po. Dun po sa age na talagang magme-menopause na po tayo. Ito din po. Tataba po ba ako kapag nagpa-ligate ako? Ano po yung sagot ninyo? Hindi. Wala rin pong evidence na yung ligation will cause women to gain weight. Pag magana lang po tayong kumain, yun, dun po tayo mag-gain weight. Pero yung ligation, wag na po nating isisi sa ligation pag tumaba po tayo. Di po ba? So, is ligation a painful and complicated procedure? Masakit ba pag nagpa-ligate ako? At mahirap bang gawin yon? Sasabihin po natin sa pasyente, meron po tayong anesthesia. So, the answer is no. During the procedure, naka-anesthesia po tayo, kaya hindi nyo po mararamdaman yung procedure mismo. After the procedure, dun lang po natin may mararamdaman na discomfort like pain on the surgical side, which is almost always relieved with basic pain relievers and medications like po yung ating paracetamol, ibuprofen, and mefenamic acid. Nagkakaroon ba tayo ng ectopic pregnancy after ligation? Yun po yung tanong. Pag na-ligate po ako, mag-ectopic pregnancy po ba ako? The answer is no, because after ligation, we face less risk of having an ectopic pregnancy than women who have not had ligation. Actually, the same lang yung risk of having ectopic pregnancy sa mga nabuntis at sa mga hindi pa na ligate at sa mga ligated. So there is less risk of having an ectopic pregnancy. So on the finances po ulit, financial side, will the PhilHealth cover the cost of ligation? Opo. Kasi nga po, meron po tayong benefit package for ligation. Pwede rin po siya sa mga dependent ng ating mga member ng PhilHealth. Now, we go to the male counterpart of our tubal ligation or our bilateral tubal ligation. And on the male part, it is the vasectomy or non-scalpel vasectomy. So usually it is ginagawa siya as an outpatient procedure wherein a small puncture is made on the scrotum, the vas deferens is cut and tied, and it also requires local anesthesia. Yung local anesthesia lang po ang i-inject. So what happens here? Okay. So sana mag-play po ito para mapanood
natin. The testicle is where spermatozoid are produced. Each testicle has a tube called the vas. The spermatozoid go into the vas, up into the abdomen towards the prostate, and then out. The vasectomy is a quick and simple surgical procedure that blocks the tube from each testicle. After local anesthesia, the doctor feels the tube under the skin and using his fingers brings it towards the surface. Then he immobilizes the tube under the skin using a small round clip. Feel absolutely no pain as the skin and the tube are anesthetized. Carefully, the doctor opens the skin a few millimeters. Then he turns the clip to bring part of the tube outside the skin. He makes a small cut on each side of the tube. He uses an instrument with a heated tip to cauterize the end of the tube that goes to the abdomen. Then he repeats the same procedure to the end of the tube that goes to the testicle. The doctor then applies a titanium clip to the end that goes to the abdomen. He cuts a part of the tube so that the two ends can no longer touch each other. After this, he lets the tube go back to...
Parang nawala po yung video. Okay. Anyway, yung vasectomy po. Okay. So this is what... Sorry. This is what happens when we do the vasectomy. So, ang kinakat lang po dito is yung tube na dadaanan ng sperm. Hindi po tatanggalin yung buong testicle ng ating kalalakihan. Hindi po siya kagaya ng sa animals na yung kinakapon. Hindi po yon. Ang vasectomy is yung vas deferens natin or yung tube lang na daanan ng sperm ang kinakat and tie. Like in the female, yung fallopian tube, sa male, yung vas deferens. So, once na nakat na po ito and tied, the sperm cannot be ejaculated anymore. Dito siya dadaan. So, pag yung sperm na nandito sa testicles, it will go up there and then papunta dito. But, in vasectomy, wala na pong sperm na nakakalabas sa ating penis. Yun, kagaya ng sabi ko po, vasectomy is not the same as castration. Kasi yung castration, it is a removal of the testes. It is only done sa mga animals natin. And it does not, sa ating mga kalalakihan, it does not involve the removal of the testes. Siyempre, ito rin po, kapag na-vasectomize ba ako, ano na, parang less na yung pagiging lalaki ko. Actually, no. Kasi it will not make a man less macho or make him effeminate. So, it does not interfere with any normal body function nor cause other types of changes. So, kung ano ka po, before ka ma-vasectomize, ganun ka pa rin after vasectomy. So, it will not cause other types of changes. And after vasectomy, a man will continue to produce the male hormone or the testosterone. So, ang vasectomy, hindi po siya castration or kapon. Ito rin po. So, ano na mangyayari sa sperm that are not ejaculated during sexual intercourse? Will they accumulate in the semen and cause it to burst or cause other problems? The answer is, hindi rin. No. Because the body will just absorb the sperm that is not ejaculated. Sperm cannot accumulate in the scrotum nor cause the scrotum to burst or harm the body in any other way. So, meron pong paraan yung ating katawan para po i-eliminate yung sperm na hindi nailabas ng ating from the penis, na i-ejaculate. So, does it also cause cancer? Pag na-vasectomize ba ako, magkaka-cancer ako? The answer is, wala. Kasi tinanggal lang naman po yung part ng vas deferens. So, clinical studies indicate that vasectomy does not cause prostate cancer or cancer of the testicles or any other long-term health problems. Will it also cause heart problems and harm my immune system? Yun ang tatanoy ng mga kalalakihan natin. Ang sagot po natin ay no. So, wala rin pong evidence na it increases the risk of cardiovascular disease or immune system problems. Okay, so I think that's the last slide. I hope you learned something from the correction of our myths and facts. Sana po, pag may tinanong na po sa atin ng mga kliyente natin, masasagot na po natin ng kung ano yung tama po na dapat nilang maintindihan. Kaya wag po nating kalimutan na kausapin ang ating mga kliyente sa ating komunidad. At sabihin natin, usap tayo sa family planning dahil ang pamilyang planado ay protektado. Salamat po.
Thank you so much rin po, Doc Maureen, for your very enlightening and comprehensive lecture. So indeed, it is very important to plan for our family because of its benefits to all parents and the whole family. Ito nga yung mga nabanggit ni Doc Maureen kanina. But, hindi lang ito beneficial sa mga couples but also for the community. So, planuhin natin ng mabuti ang kinabukasan ng ating pamilya because failing to plan is planning to fail. So, again, thank you so much, Doc Maureen, for clarifying the myths o mga maling paniniwala at kagawian natin sa family planning. At siya nga po pala ang department head natin sa BJHMC Family Planning Clinic. Kaya sa ating mga participants po na interesado o may mga inquiries tungkol sa family planning, maaari po kayong bumisita sa ating OPD Family Planning Clinic dito po sa BJHMC. So, again, let us give her a virtual round of applause.
Salamat po. Thank you.